Time now for the Sunday Talk, where we tap into the debate of the week. Does Omar Khadr deserve a $10.5 million settlement?
Born in Canada, Omar Khadr's childhood was steeped in Al-Qaeda ideology. His father, a friend of Osama bin Laden, took him to Afghanistan to fight. When the U.S. invaded after 9/11, 15-year-old Khadr was shot and captured, accused of throwing a grenade that killed American soldier Christopher Spear. He became the youngest detainee at the notorious U.S. prison in Guantanamo. He was subjected to sleep deprivation and denied legal counsel.
He was a victim. He wasn't a mastermind and a perpetrator of anything.
The Canadian Supreme Court ruled Khadr's human rights were violated and that Canada shared the blame. After he pled guilty to war crimes, Khadr was allowed to serve the rest of his time in Canada, but later recanted his confession, saying he'd been under duress. He sued the Canadian government for $20 million. All along, Khadr's been a polarizing figure.
Omar Khadr is a well-known supporter of the Al-Qaeda terrorist network and a convicted terrorist.
Conservatives tried to keep him behind bars, but an Alberta court released him on bail. The Liberal government has now settled the case, paying him $10.5 million.
A Canadian citizen's charter rights were violated. As a result, the Government of Canada was required to provide a remedy.
This payout is a slap in the face to the men and women in uniform who face incredible danger every day to keep us safe.
I'm joined now by our panelists. Supriya Dwivedi is a talk radio host in Toronto. Jonathan Kay is an author and freelance columnist. And Tasha Carradine is a talk radio host and columnist with iPolitics. So, this is really divided the media, it's divided Canadians in general, certainly the political parties. What do you think, Tasha? Was that settlement right or wrong?
I think it was wrong. I think that, as you said, there was a violation of Omar Khadr's rights that was found by the Supreme Court. Does that entitle him to $10.5 million? I think that is the question to look at here. There was no monetary amount attached to the Supreme Court's decision. It was not in a civil proceeding. The government is not letting a civil proceeding play out here. They are saying, well, we figure we would lose, so let's cut our losses, essentially. We don't know what the court would have found. And we also don't know, in this case, what is going to happen to Omar Khadr's claim in the United States that his conviction should be overturned, that he did save us under duress. The court has not ruled on that either. So with all these legal things hanging, I think it's immensely hypocritical for this government that is pursuing other cases for veterans' pensions, for example, that is not paying out additional sums to First Nations children who were found to have their human rights violated by the courts as well, to suddenly capitulate in this case.
What do you think, Supriya?
So I do agree with Tasha that it does seem that the Liberal government is picking and choosing which cases they're going to settle out of court in and which ones that they're going to proceed all the way. But I disagree in terms of that this is very much, ooh, we don't know what would have happened. We have, now a bunch of rulings by the Supreme Court that say that his rights were violated. We do know that the Charter does apply to Canadians, irrespective of what territory you find yourself on. As a Canadian is a Canadian is a Canadian. And even though morally and politically, we may not like the judgment. Legally, I think that it's sound.
What do you think, John? I mean, I guess there's the legal argument. There's also, does he deserve it? The arguments made he's a child soldier.
Yeah, and by the way, most forms of litigation end in some kind of settlement or plea bargain. It's hardly unusual that this would be settled before the case goes to its full length. From a moral point of view, I do think he does deserve it. He was a 15-year-old child, as was mentioned in the setup package. He was the youngest detainee at Guantanamo, and you'd have to go back to the Second World War to find an instance in which someone that young was treated the way Omar Khadr was treated. It's completely unusual, even given the lack of due process that took place at Guantanamo and in Afghanistan during that period. This stood out as a particularly egregious example, violating the rights of someone who was a child and who was programmed from youth to be a terrorist. I don't think he had the same moral responsibility for his actions that someone like his dad did, or like the other detainees at Guantanamo.
Well, you wrote a piece this week suggesting that he was scapegoated. I mean, What do you think beyond the legal arguments here?
I mean, it does seem that Khadr is becoming the lightning post for a lot of the frustration that's felt by the right in terms of how this government has handled, you know, a bunch of issues. And I think they are scapegoating him. And I think that they're, in some cases, willingly misleading the public, even in terms of having Peter McKay, who is the former attorney general. He should know full well that the charter does apply to Canadians, whether or not you're found in Canada or not. And yet you hear him spewing out those talking points. I would say Aaron O'Toole also is another Conservative MP who has gone out there and on murky water, who by himself is also a lawyer, so he should know better. And that's what I find very troubling about this, that this isn't just feelings. This is actually, this is the law.
Well, the charter does apply. I wouldn't go as far as some of the politicians who are saying that it's just a moral outrage and that is the reason that we should just ignore the charter. I think the charter does apply. It does. But the issue is, like I said, there's the issue of the quantum. There's the issue also of the fact that Khadr himself now, with this money, half of it's gone to the lawyers, probably. We say apparently he has split the money with his lawyers. That is the reports that are out there. A lot of people are questioning the motivations as well here. He's going to be benefiting from a sum of money. We don't know what's going to happen to that money as well. Is it going to go to help defend his sister, Zainab, who is in custody for allegedly terrorist-related activities as well? I think that's one of the issues.
In Turkey.
In Turkey, exactly. And a lot of people, I think because of his family connections, I hear you that he was programmed from a childhood. He had, you know, one could say he had no choice, but did he have no choice to throw that grenade that he did admit throwing that killed Private Speer? That fact that he admitted has not been erased.
Yeah, but it wasn't in a proper court of law. It wasn't an adversarial procedure with our norms and evidentiary.
But the court has to rule. The court has to rule on that they have not done so.
But if we could step back from that, it's true. He did admit to throwing the grenade. I come back to the fact that it was on a battlefield. Usually when we use the term terrorist, we're colloquially talking about people who blow up buses and restaurants and that sort of thing. Sergeant Speer, who was the victim, it was obviously horrible that he died, but he died doing what he was trained to do. He died in a proper pitched firefight in Afghanistan. And it's not, and when people say, oh, he was a terrorist, yes, he was trained to be a terrorist, but it was actually a military engagement in which this took place. And I should also say, one of the most
cynical... Then a military tribunal technically should rule. If you're saying it's a military engagement,
but
then
as Supriya
one should
was
say
that
the rules of military engagement should apply.
The rules of due process at a military tribunal are not the same as you would see in a court here in Canada. And it's pretty clear that children were subject to special exemptions in those military tribunals.
We have three lawyers here, so this could get very deep. But a lot of Canadians they don't get it. I mean, you even tweeted today, John, that, you know, a lot of your journalist friends agree with you, but that regular people don't. Is the government, I'm sure you think they are, Tasha Supriya, do you? Is the government a little bit out of touch on this question?
I mean,
do you think he actually deserves it and that people can understand that?
I think there's a very good reason why people are angry, and I don't fault people for being angry about the situation, but the reality is that had previous Liberal and Conservative governments not failed Khadr's rights abroad, we wouldn't even be in the situation. And the fact is that the Harper government took this to court as long as they could, and even when the 2010 ruling did come out from the Supreme Court, they waited another 2 years to actually repatriate him.
There's no question. Yes, they waited that period of time. Is that the violation that is being found here by the Supreme Court? No, the Supreme Court said it was Canada's involvement in providing intelligence, sharing intelligence with the United States, and
accepting
information.
But beyond the legal argument, Tasha, do you think that the government has misread Canadians?
Absolutely. I think they don't understand. They don't understand, and like I said, especially because there are other cases out there, other situations where they have chosen to pursue cases at taxpayer expense.
If I could just jump in, though, I think that perhaps the Trudeau government underestimated how much people would object to this. But sometimes it is the responsibility of governments to do unpopular things
when it's
mandated
yes.
by the charter. I should also say two things that might explain the popular response. One, once you label someone a terrorist, it becomes this magic designation that says you are beyond the rules of due process and you can just do whatever you want with them. I reject that, but there are a lot of people who don't, and they say, oh, Khadr's a terrorist, so, you know, throw the book at him, it doesn't matter. The other thing is there's this cynical talking point you often see on Twitter that, well, this is a slap in the face to the memory of Sergeant Speer. I don't buy that either. You could mourn Sergeant Speer, but at the same time say Sergeant Speer was killed by someone who was programmed to kill as a child, and he was mistreated in part thanks to our government.
We treat children as adults in certain cases. We do. We don't simply ascribe absolutely no responsibility to
children. But with an abundance of due process, which wasn't the case at the military tribunal. You saw the video.
John, we don't know. You weren't there. And I think that the fact that in this case, that's the other piece, is the optics of it, is that Sergeant Speer, his widow, Tabitha Speer, at this point has very, it's going to be very difficult for her because the payout's been done to access any of this money. And I think that is also part of it, is the sense that there has been a miscarriage of justice in that there was an application filed to get whatever compensation could be obtained, and this was then rushed through right after the payout was made, which pretty much almost preempted getting it.
Rushed through? This has been like a 10-year
ordeal. No, because
ordeal.
June 8th was when it was filed by Tabitha Speer's lawyers.
What do you think, you follow communications and how they'll handle it in Ottawa. What do you think of the way that this was handled? I mean,
terribly.
The Prime Minister was out of the country. Mm-hmm. We still don't know the details
but we
of
don't
what
know
the apology
details.
Said.
But they've paid out other people whose rights have been violated, and we don't know the details of this. We don't know the details of any of these deals that go down.
Crimes. Mahar Arar, who's been cited here.
There are
as
also three other men just as early as March, I believe, who have been paid out. The general secrecy around these deals is stands. And I agree, they're not necessarily completely equivalent situations. Mm-hmm. But I think ultimately, when you have a government that is standing up to do the right thing in the face of, you know, outrage, I think that, as John pointed out, they do have a responsibility. The responsibility isn't to feelings and how we feel about things. The responsibility is to the Canadian Charter of Rights
I
and Freedom.
I also sense that the exact same people who are objecting, saying there's not enough information, if they were provided with all the information, the exact same people would object just because they don't want to see somebody who's been labeled a terrorist get money.
There will be people who have that response. I completely agree with you. But people, like I said, Mahar Arar was labeled a terrorist. He was in prison for a year. It turns out he did nothing wrong. There you can say his rights were violated, compensation was provided. Is there an equivalency here? No. Stephen Truscott was alleged to have committed a crime, was a criminal, wore that for 48 years. He got $6.5 million for his 10 years in jail.
The release of this in the middle of the summer with the Prime Minister out of the country, one could suspect that the Liberals are hoping this will blow over.
Yeah, it will blow over.
Will it?
It's a comms win, I think, for them, ultimately. Mm.
It's a huge issue for Conservatives.
I don't think it'll blow over at all for Conservatives, but the House is no longer sitting. Yeah, people 2 years from now, when they go to vote, aren't going to be thinking about the Khadr payment. They're going to be thinking how the economy is, how their house prices are doing, and if their kids
got to wrap up in a moment.
I'm not a comms expert. As I think my, I've demonstrated in the past. However, I would say that Khadr's name will be used as a dog whistle.
It will.
It will be used as a dog whistle to say Trudeau is soft on terrorism and he's going to let guys like this into the country.
We are out of time. I'm sorry.
I
know
disagree.
That we could go on with this. It's been quite a political week for a hot day in July. Thank you so much, and we'll see you soon.